Why do I keep using tech? The thing is that if you look at my what I'm currently doing here, I'm spending really a lot of time on the development of LuaTech, and at the same time, if you look a bit around to development of programs, and especially the speed in which they develop in general, you sometimes wonder, am I doing the right thing there? What is the average lifetime of a program? It's nearly, maybe nothing, a few years, and then you already get new versions. Now, if you consider the development time of LuaTech, which is a couple of years down the road before it's finished, or you talk about 4 or 5 years, that's normally the lifespan of a program that you buy and then suddenly disappears. So it could as well be that by the time that we are finished, we have to conclude that we have to start again with the next thing, or that the thing has become obsolete. Nevertheless, there's a reason why I'm still using tech, otherwise I wouldn't be standing here. And I will reflect on this from three perspectives. One is fonts, the other one is graphics, and yet another one is typesetting itself. Now, some of the things might sound a little bit negative, so let's start with a couple of positive things. First of all, for me personally, it's fun to use tech. I just like to do it, tech and MetaPose, because output looks nice, you can make nice things. I have to admit that many times in my daily work, if I have to use tech, output is not as nice as I would like it to be, just because it's specified by others or whatever. But the things that I can do privately are, well, giving some fun, or the things that either showed that you basically do in your all the time that you're not professionally working on tech are fun to work on. Some of the problems are challenging, and I'm always surprised by what weird questions users can come up with, and sometimes it's fun to solve it. A really important thing is that the community is kind of special, and you have at a certain moment you have your friends in the tech world and you go to meetings and things like that. So that's a good argument to keep using tech. Although I find that there are quite some people coming to meetings who don't use tech actually that much in their work anymore. But I keep coming, which is interesting in itself. And of course tech is kind of equivalent to Don Knut, and that's a good argument to, well, stay in that world too. Okay, so much for the good news. So the first thing I want to reflect a bit on is fonts. When you start using tech, and well, when I started doing it I paid quite some money to get some version of tech that ran on the PC. Then you install these fonts, you get your printer running, and well, what you get is computer modern. And so basically that is your perspective of fonts. One of the reasons why you actually start using tech is often mass, and well, tech shipped with mass fonts, and as there are no other fonts around, at least at the time that I started, well, you were stuck to using the computer modern font anyway. Okay, and then you, at a certain point, you want to broaden your horizon a bit. You say, I've seen another font and I want to use it, and then that's where the real problems start. Not so much in the English language regions, but in Europe we have special characters with accents and whatever, and that adds quite some complication to fonts. And fonts are somehow tied to languages, if you think about hyphenation, so that adds another level of complexity. The number of slots in a font, I'm not talking about traditional tech, is limited to 256, another dimension. And not all fonts have the characters that you're looking for. Now, at some point when we started writing our own macros, you have to start thinking about your own font system, you start writing it, etc., etc. In the beginning, you are naive, you do it and it works out quite well. But at certain points, you have to make styles with mixed font sets, multiple languages, things like that, and that's where the real mess starts. I think fonts is one of the reasons why there are so few macro packages. I think that that Tech originally started, that Don Knuth put Tech there and gave us Tech with the idea that there would be multiple macro packages. And I think that one of the reasons that there are only a few is that as soon as you, it's easy to set up something that just gives output, but as soon as you want to do something more complex, you need to really come up with systems and subsystems. And that's non-trivial. If you start using Tech professionally, it gets even worse, because the way that Tech kind of forces you to think in systematic ways is definitely not the way designers think. They just think in, I choose a font, I choose a site, I choose some kind of inline spacing and apply it to certain things. So implementing style is complex in itself. So no matter how many tools or any macros or whatever you make, font is always somewhat complex. And then I'm not even talking about the special scripts, yeah, the non-Latin scripts. Okay, and then you slowly see it coming. There's type one, and you see around, look around it at, let's say, the modern operating system, and you say, oh, wait a minute, all the fonts are showing up, two type, open type, whatever. And Tech really tries to survive then by, okay, we can take this big font and we split it up in pieces, and then, well, for a while, you somehow can mix the pieces and you can keep afloat. But then the next thing popped up, it's Unicode. And, well, yeah, that enlarges the repertoire, so you no longer really can deal with this 256 thing. And I think that especially if you look at it from the perspective of a macro writer who has to support many users and much demand, I think I can safely say, you can may disagree with me, that Tech would have become pretty unusable if the situation would not have changed. And I think that if the situation wouldn't have changed, I would probably have quit using Tech at a certain point, because it became unusable. Lucky us that the situation did change. As already mentioned, PDF Tech started getting some support that for including TrueType fonts. At a certain point, the Tech Gaia project, the Latin Modern and Tech Gaia project, started producing output, which means that we have, as Jim already told you, finally we got things in order, as I tried to say. I think if that wouldn't have happened, well, Carl, you're the guy of the fonts and the names. It is a mess, yeah? And especially for new users, that is no fun. Then CTech showed up and demonstrated that it's possible to have a Tech which actually works. Omega tried it before, but I think Omega never reached production quality. But CTech did and showed us that we are able to survive in a Unicode and OpenType font world, which is a good thing. And there's another thing that I think that should not be neglected. If you look around here, how many people use Apples? Yeah. Apple has traditionally been the platform for designers, people who were active in that area. And all the interesting things with regards to, I think, fonts and other design issues happened on the Mac somehow. And I think that the fact that the Tech world was able to connect with this world is kind of interesting in itself. Not in the last place, because there is some kind of, as I would say, masochism in using Tech, like, oh, you can always compile Tech for this platform, or you can do that kind of stuff. Now, normal users don't want to do that. Yeah? Normal users want to use the system. A while later, LuaTech showed up. Well, not accidentally that I'm involved in that, which provides more access to the font machinery, and for me personally, that's important because it gives you the idea that you can fill in the niches. Tech has, to a large extent, and I'm not talking explicitly about Mars now, survived because it could fill in those special areas that no other program could fill in. In special linguistic areas and things like that. If you look at the amount of fonts that is there, okay, most of them are metafonts or whatever, that are used for very special purposes, it clearly demonstrates that tech has a role in areas that go, I would say, a bit beyond math. Yeah? We always say, okay, tech is good in paragraphs and math, but tech is a tunable system. I think that without the Unicode-aware engines, in this case I'm talking about CTech and LuaTech, tech would have had no future. And we would have gone extinct, or probably been close to extinct. So I think that the fact that these changes are there, the modern engines as well as the LM and Gaia projects, are one of the reasons that I'm still around and why I'm still using FAIR. So much about fonts. Another important area is graphics. Traditional tech can only draw straight lines, and even if you have been fooled in the past by packages like PicTech, as soon as you zoom in, you will know that it can draw only 5-1-point periods, and then or pretend that it's drawing curves or whatever. But it can do only straight lines, and as a result of that, rectangles, filled rectangles. However, don't put two things in tech, the special primitive and the right primitive, which actually are there as examples of extensions. I think they are not even there as let's say basic functionality. No, it's a demonstration that you can extend tech. The fact that they are there is, in my opinion, the reason that tech is around at all. If we didn't have these openings, if we couldn't misuse specials and whatever to communicate with a backend to include graphics or whatever, I think tech would have never reached the position it has now. So it would be interesting to ask Dom, in retrospect, if he would have that somehow subconsciously in mind when he had those extensions. There has been some special define that could do some graphic stuff, but I don't think they ever reached the level that is needed to do really professional graphic inclusion in tech. There are a couple of powerful drawing packages. PSTrix is a good example. A tick set, there was talk about it, is also a good example. And of course we have MetaPost. For me, MetaPost was really, what you say, when I ran into it, it was, I probably told it before, more fun than tech. It's one of the nicest things that happens. The nice thing about MetaPose is, at some point you know the language and you know that there's not more, so you can concentrate on what's there, instead of thinking, what I'm not seeing. So I started using that extensively, and it's, I can safely say, one of the reasons that the company that I run with my colleague is still around. Because it permits us to do completely automated typesetting workflows that in the documents support things like backgrounds as cross pages, nested backgrounds, very complex macro of graphic solutions that have to be part of the text flow that other applications cannot provide. And if we couldn't do that, there was no reason to use tech to produce those books, and I'm talking in most cases about school books, which have special demands in their own way. So we use MetaPost so much that it really became a bottleneck. There was a project where we're talking about, let's say, 400 page documents. They were processed on the server, quite complex documents with lots of graphics that have to fetch from databases, things like that. Anyhow, processing such a document took 20 minutes. So if this is part of a proofing workflow, that is not really fun. You could process small pieces, but somehow the proofers don't think that way. They always want the whole document. And that was something that I got the impression, way, yeah, the styles that I have to write become more and more demanding, but the system that I have, I cannot speed it up anymore. I already optimized it quite well. So in order to survive and keep using tech, that situation had to be improved. Now, as I told you when I was talking about the performance issues in Lua Tech, we have the MetaPose library, which has a throughput of 20,000 graphics per second. So it basically means that this bottleneck is completely gone. It opens up new possibilities. Of course, you can do more tricky things than you used to do, but it suddenly makes tech, for me, usable again. Of course, if you are in business, and as long as you can do things that no other people can do, it's fine. But okay, the competition is not sitting there and let it happen. So I think that the second reason why I'm still using tech and will keep using tech is a tight integration of MetaPose into tech, or more precisely, of graphics into tech. Of course, there are the other graphic packages, but MetaPose is really handy for the very basic graphic things that you want to do. We've now arrived at the typesetting part, the third factor. And I think that there is absolutely no doubt that tech can do a good job on typesetting. And I somehow hope that context is a demonstration that the tech can do that. I also think that if you look at practice in most situations, that you can find a solution for a problem. I tend to say that whatever problem you come up with, it's solvable somehow. Don't ask me how much time or trouble or whatever it takes, but so far there has never been anything that was not solvable. Of course, the imagination of the people asking me what to solve probably was a factor in that. But it becomes more and more complex due to the fact that all these systems have to somehow work with each other, as you were mentioning with the equation thing. It basically true for all the subsystems that somehow have to work together, and there's simply no way that you can predict this. It usually do things that, well. Not all the problems that you come up with have clean solutions. So even if you say, wow, this is fantastic, this can be done, if you really look at the code, you would say, this is not really the way I want to solve this problem. Another thing is that some of the problems have multiple solutions. Think multiple columns is a good example. There is no one way to deal with multiple columns. If I had time and motivation, I would probably already have 10 or 20 multi-column environments, and now we have three basic, fundamentally different ones. So there are multiple solutions, multiple problems that can be meshed. So at some point you more and more reach a moment and say, this is no longer fun writing. Yeah, I've been here before, I know this is going to take me a week, do I want to do it? Especially, let's say, to be honest, 90% of what you do is there is unpaid work and ends up in evenings and weekends, so you need some motivation. Let me just mention a few of the things that you run into. Grid snapping. Tech is not particularly strong on grid snapping. I think the contact does a reasonable job, but it's tricky, especially if users start doing things that you don't expect. Vertical spacing models, to come up with a vertical spacing model that is really, really robust, is not easy. This is the one area where I think that the formatting object people, XML formatting object people, did it right. They have a model that somehow is more suitable for document. The rest is just crap, but that bit is good. So I actually implemented that now in Lua Tech. If you want to do manipulations with content or whatever, that's always a bit tricky. I'm always end up with less optimal things that you than you would like. Then you have all these languages that have special demands. The most famous example is French. It's French. where they have spaces before the punctuation. And the traditional way to do that is to make these punctuation things active. Well, if I say active, you have already said enough about the dangers of things becoming active. That really influences all the aspects of your system, because a colon or a semicolon or whatever moves through your system in many ways and is used in other places for other purposes as well. Scripts may have special demand, like Chinese or Arabic or whatever. Multiple columns, I already mentioned that, especially when you start combining that with graphics, the span columns or other tricky things, or span spreads or things like that. And you have can have tricky graphic placements. If you have a graphic designer who is accustomed to moving things around till he or she thinks that is right, they always define styles and whatever specification in ways that are, well, they don't fit with tech, yeah? Somehow. And it's very hard to convince people, and you can do a lot of things automatically, but there are some limitations. A good example is text flowing around the graphic. It's not a problem to implement it, but what if the graphic moves to the next page? Yeah? Paragraph shape mechanisms don't operate over paragraphs and over pages and things like that. By the way, this is one of the things that we want to cover in LuaTeX, because it's doable. So we need to find a way to keep up with these demands, or otherwise, well, I think it's end of the story. I'm also pretty well aware that there are no universal solutions, so just sitting there and start extending tech is not a solution. You can discuss forever what way you want to go, there is no universal solution. So the only possibilities that we saw was open it up to the extent that you can implement solutions. And this is what the LuaTeX project is about, which is the third factor. I think that I could not foresee how much work was involved in this. You know, it starts out simple, and you end up with re-implementing 50% or more of all the code that you have in your ways. But it's somehow rewarding. You get cleaner code, better solutions, and the interesting thing is, you more and more then end up in a situation where tech is doing what tech can do best, which is typesetting and all the other things that are involved with parsing, management and whatever. You just let that do by another system, in this case Lua, which can do that best. And that somehow gives you a good feeling. Another one is that you can re-implement solutions that are somehow fragile. You can make a robust system, but it's not that easy. And you can reconsider taking away limitations that you have built in previously. And you can also now start exploring solutions that demand much more calculations. Imagine a multi-column balancing routine, which involves graphics, is non-trivial. Yeah. Because well, tech is not it doesn't have the machinery to do that. In LuaTeX, you can build data structures and can do that. Or for instance, the modern example of breaking equations. Actually, that you can completely do that at a Lua level, because you can just look at the result in the list and determine which points are valid and not. And you need, my guess is, you need 20% of the code, or maybe even less than what you would need if you would do it in tech, like that. Development time is, I think, currently close to the ridiculous, but I hope to gain back some time when the thing is finished, because then you finally hope that you can do things in a more friendly way. So the third thing that keeps me going and keeps me using Tef is actually the Lua Tef project. So to summarize, there are three reasons why I still use Tef. The first is that we have the proper fonts now, or at least are approaching the proper fonts, and have the engines that can deal with those fonts. The second is the Metalib project, which is actually now going into its second stage of enlarging MetaPose and adding some extensions. And the third one is the LuaTeX and Oriental Tech project. And without these, we wouldn't have the at least I wouldn't have the flexible engine that I really need in order to keep going. Of course, if I had foreseen how much time would have been involved, I might reconsider my opinion on this, but that's about it.
Hans, do you see the possible appearance of analogs of volumes A and B of computers and typesetting, that is the LuaTeX program and the LuaTeX book?
Since
other people are going to build on this for decades to come, we need some really solid documentation pretty early on.
Yeah, there are actually two things that we really try to keep in sync with the development. One is the document that I mentioned, which is a kind of history of how things evolved, and we try to more or less summarize what happened, why we did it, and why it's done. The second thing is the reference manual. So there is a reference manual that has most of the information, and we have plans when thing is finished to come up with a more explorative book or whatever or resource that tells you how to use it. Because at that moment we probably also have lots of examples and code, because that's what you need, yeah, in order to show the potential of this. But we have definitely plans to provide that kind of resources. Also because that is my experience with writing the MetaFund manual, actually, is by writing down how to use it is the best test case for your system.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's
when
John developed literate programming, because he debugged it as he was explaining it to another human.
Yeah. That's also why the literate programming is not abandoned here. So Taco has now converted all the Pascal to C, and the next thing will be to merge in the, or to reformat or whatever, the code into CWeb. Which, by the way, introduces an interesting problem. We have been discussing this, but there is no clear answer to that. You know, Don has his comments, put his comments in Tech the program. Now, if you extend that, who is the author? How is copyright arranged? This is something that I wonder if it ever came up.
I've never heard it discussed.
You know,
probably the simple thing to do is just ask Don and say, sure.
You know, Don has a special way of writing things. Or
right,
whatever.
I mean, we're not changing tech, we're adding on to what he did. And
yeah, but
you're adding on to what he did.
Yeah, but say that there's a paragraph explaining something, and take Mars, yeah? Aditya didn't go into detail about that, but the Mars engine had been extended. Yeah? In order to support the things that OpenType provides, we have extended the Mars engine. So, and there are, for instance, primitive operations for all the things that so far were not primitive. There probably is an article in Tugboat at some point about these issues. So you need to add this information to, let's say, LuaTeX the program. Yeah? So you start mixing Don's comment in his special writing style with, well, our comments in our less interesting writing style. So whose document is it? I think this has never been addressed, is it?
We'll have to talk about it.
Yeah.
I think you're co-authors. I mean, that's the reality of the situation. You know, your he was the original author 30 years ago.
Yeah.
You're the new author now.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems like
the same is actually true for MetaPose. Yeah, MetaPose
right.
is built upon MetaFont.
Right.
Now it's also being extended.
Right.
Does it answer the question?
Yeah.
Anyone else? Well, thank you, Hans.
Thank you.